for so many things from the Lord, but I was reminded that in His presence, listen, if we experience His presence, everything we need, we find and we receive in His presence. Amen? Look, Stephen's job, my job, is not to manufacture something, an emotional thrill ride at church. Our job is to help everyone into the very presence of God. I feel like we've experienced some of that this morning. Well, we've had all kinds of malfunctions today, and our sound man had to take himself to the ER. If it gets any more exciting at Broadway on Sunday mornings, I'm going to quit coming. I'm just telling you right now. Too much excitement. We wanted to do something special after that video, and since I didn't see it, I can't act it out for you or anything like that. We would love for all the moms to stand up. Would you stand up, moms? All the moms, just stand up. Let's give them a round of applause. You know, Brother Mike prayed so sweet. Remain standing, ladies. He prayed such a sweet prayer, but y'all play such a crucial role in our lives. And I know Mother's Day can be a bittersweet day for so many ladies. Some ladies who've never been able to give birth, or some ladies who've given birth and lost a child at birth, or at what feels like such a premature age. But here's what we can do. We don't want to stir the pot of bittersweet feelings. What we want to do is say, Lord, thank you for some of the finest ambassadors for the kingdom of God that we'll ever experience. Moms. And so just receive those applause as a genuine word of thanksgiving. We're so very grateful for all of you. Would you be seated, please? Thank you for everything you've done. And then Broadway has a long-standing tradition. It really ought to be the tradition in every church. But the Bible says to give honor to those whom honor is due. Sometimes missionaries roll through and we don't catch them all. And there's some missionaries here that won't be recognized today. Sorry, y'all, but your time's coming. I mean, we've recognized you on so many times. And Bill's from Texas. I said, I don't really like Texas people sitting this close to the platform while I preach. It makes me a little bit uncomfortable. So you know we love you. But we've got some guests from the country of Belize, Roberto and Patricia Sabido, and they've been in Laurel, Mississippi with some of our folks for a International Convention for the Hellfighters Ministry, and Roberto serves as the president of the Hellfighter Unit in Belize. And I want to tell you, it's one of the more active units in the entire ministry, and they are sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ in that little nation. I want Roberto and Patricia to stand up. Let's welcome them. We honor you today as servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. Roberto is affectionately referred to as chief, and he is the chief, and he's not only the chief of sinners who's been gloriously saved, but he's the chief of an incredible ministry that involves men and women in a little country named Belize. You remember them and pray for them. We're so honored to have you with us today. Open your Bibles to the little prophetic book of Habakkuk. Habakkuk, if you need to use your table of contents in your Bible, you feel free to do that, but I'll let you find it. The book of Habakkuk, and I wanted to preach this message a couple of weeks ago. And I want to say at the very beginning, it's amazing to me how the Lord used this passage in my life to prepare me and ultimately to prepare our family for something that no one would ever expect or want to experience. What do you do when you've prayed to the Lord and you don't like the answer you received? Does that ever happen to you? You pray in faith, you pray with a spirit of expectancy. When the answer comes, you're going, well, that's not what I wanted. You've applied for the college of your dreams. They said no. You interviewed for a job, but they found somebody more qualified. You asked God for healing, but the doctors said the chemo treatments didn't work. You prayed for a husband, and after all these years, he hadn't found you yet. You asked her to marry you, and she said, no. You sunk your life savings into a new business, only to see it fail a year later. You never intended to end up divorced, but you're single today. You planned on having more children, but it's not happening for some reason. I mean, we've all been there, most of us, many times, because that's the way life is. You have your dreams, you make your plans, you sincerely seek the Lord, you pray to the Lord, and when the answer comes, it's not what you wanted. What do you do then? See, we don't talk about that kind of stuff very often in church, but we need to. I'm convinced if you live long enough, you'll discover that God's plan and yours often are not the same. It's true. I mean, we all know that we should pray, Lord, thy will be done. And most of us do. And yet still, it jolts us when we discover that God's plan is completely different from ours. Enter Habakkuk. See, he's been praying, and Habakkuk doesn't like the answer he's received. We discovered a few weeks ago that, first of all, Habakkuk thought God was ignoring Judah's sin. Secondly, he thought God could never and would never use Babylon to judge Judah. Wrong both times. What do you do when God doesn't live up to your expectations? How do you respond when the Lord's answer isn't what you wanted? Habakkuk was troubled, deeply troubled by something that troubles all of us. Habakkuk could not reconcile his view of God with the injustice of what he was seeing and experiencing all around him. I mentioned during my son's funeral service that George Barna, the pollster, asked Americans this question: if you could ask God one question and know God would give you an answer, what would you ask for? The overwhelming response was this: why is there pain and suffering in the world? Makes sense. There's so much pain everywhere we look, and we wonder, where does it come from? And secondly, why does God allow it? C.S. Lewis once remarked that the problem of suffering is atheism's greatest weapon against the Christian faith. Why'd that tornado hit there and not there? Why'd that little girl get kidnapped, and why was that one spared? Why was that little child born with a deformity? I mean, why? The list of questions seems endless. And when we consider the sadness, the despair that we see all around us, we can sit around and offer all the commentary we want, but at some point, you and I've got to deal with God. See, and that brings us back to the little book of Habakkuk. Written approximately in 605 BC, it's the story of one man of faith, a man of God, who wrestled with God about the hard questions in three short chapters, 56 verses. Habakkuk brings us face to face with some of the deepest mysteries in life. The outline of the book is pretty straightforward. Chapter 1, faith tested. Chapter 2, faith taught. Chapter 3, faith triumphant. Maybe the most beautiful thing about this book is the change that we see taking place in the man Habakkuk. I mean, in three chapters, in 56 verses, we see Habakkuk go from fear to faith, from burden to blessing, from perplexity to praise, from confusion to confidence, and finally, from worry to worship. See, it all boils down to this one fact. God tells Habakkuk, the Babylonians are coming, you can't stop them. When they reach Jerusalem, they'll conquer it, and eventually they'll destroy it. I'm using them to judge Judah for her sins. And when Habakkuk hears God's plan, when he hears God's intentions, it blows his mind. And here's what he's thinking: God, how can you do that? It's the very key to the book. These 56 verses are really a dialogue between a frustrated man of faith and a God whose ways he cannot understand. Do you see it? In the last half of Habakkuk 1, the prophet has three questions for God. And after asking these questions, he's going to make a decision that will shape the rest of the book. So question number one, verse 12, Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 12. O Lord, are you not from everlasting? Question mark. My God, my Holy One, we will not die. O Lord, you have appointed them to execute judgment. O rock, you've ordained them to punish. He's asking, who are you? Are you not from everlasting? See, when things don't make sense, what do you do with your God? When things don't make sense, what do you do with your faith? Well, you either walk away from your faith or you remind yourself of who God really is. Sometimes, I know most common folks don't think this way, but sometimes the best thing we need, the best thing that we could do is get a good dose of theology to strengthen our faltering faith. When we face the news that we don't want to hear, when we are hit with news that we can't comprehend, we just need a good dose of theology. When Habakkuk heard the news that the Babylonians would invade Judah and nothing could stop them, it rocks his world, and he's got to go back to what theologians call the first principles. Look what he calls God. He says, O Lord, are you not everlasting? The word everlasting means you're the forever God. The word everlasting means you're eternal. He's saying, you are the sovereign Lord. And by the way, he uses the word Lord. He's saying, Lord, you're the personal God of the nation of Judah. Your name is Jehovah. You're the God who made a covenant with this nation. You're the God who freed us from our enemies. You're the God who's performed miracle after miracle for us. You're the Lord. And then he says, God. That word God means you're the strong one. The word God means you're the creator. You're the majestic ruler. Nobody has more power or authority than you. And then he refers to him as the Holy One. He's simply saying, Lord, you're in a class all by yourself. You're completely set apart from sin. You're flawless. You're beautiful. You're perfect. Then he refers to him as Rock. He's the only safe place. And so Habakkuk runs to the rock of refuge. These are not small points. As Habakkuk tries to wrap his mind around the shocking truth that God is about to use Babylon to judge Judah, he goes back to what he knows to be true about God. Let me just say something. That is a vital first step for all of us when we're faced with stuff we can't understand. I mean, consider it this way. If you remove God's sovereignty, you'll always question his wisdom. If you remove his loyal love, you'll always question his faithfulness. If you remove his majesty, you'll question God's power. If you remove God's holiness, you'll always question his fairness. And if you remove his protection, you'll always question his goodness. See, the question is not, do I believe in God, but rather, what sort of God do I believe in? What sort of God do we believe in? It's a fair question. On April 24th, our family faced one of those unanswerable questions of life. When we got word that Seth had been killed in that car accident, we were immediately faced with questions that really don't have a sufficient answer. I got saved in 1974. Young and dumb and just wet behind the spiritual ears. Didn't know anything, didn't know the Bible. But by the grace of God, since 1974, I've been able to grow in my understanding of who God is and how God works. And yet, if I'm honest with all of you here today, I need to tell you something. I don't understand why that had to happen. I didn't understand it the morning of the 24th. I didn't understand it the morning we held his service here. I don't understand why that had to take place. It was a mystery then. It's a mystery now. But, listen carefully, but I've learned that faith is a choice you make. Sometimes you choose to believe because of what you see, but oftentimes, maybe most of the time, you choose to believe in spite of what you see. Amen? So as I look around the world, as I look around my world, there's so many mysterious and unanswerable questions. But I want to say to you, if there's no God and if He's not good, then nothing at all makes any sense. I want you to know that me and my family have chosen to believe. We must believe. We have no other choice, no other viable option. We're going to believe. And I've learned through my tears that my only confidence, my only hope is in God and God alone. And that's true for you too. So I've been trying to do in my own way what Habakkuk does in verse 12. I've been going back to the first principles. I've been going back to what I know is true about God. We could spend weeks on this stuff. Let me just run through them quickly. I know God is good. Amen? I know that He's holy. I know that He's just. I know that God knows all things. I know that God is love. God is love. I know that God doesn't make mistakes. He's all wise. I know the Bible that we're reading this morning is true. In fact, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's true. I told somebody once, they challenged me about my conviction. They said, "Do you believe the Bible?" I said, "I not only believe it from cover to cover, I believe the maps are inspired. I believe the Bible. It's been a rock for me. It's high ground. It's where I run when everything feels weak and shaky and when I feel vulnerable. I run to the solid truth of God's glorious word. I know that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, the way, the truth, and the life. And nobody comes to the Father except through Him. I know that. I know He died on the cross. Praise God, I believe and I know that He rose from the dead. I know that He ascended back into heaven. I know someday, sooner than any of us can imagine, He's going to return. And I know the Holy Spirit's real. That's why when we welcomed Him here this morning, it was such a real invitation for me. I hope it was for you. Holy Spirit, You are welcome here. Oh my goodness, what a sweet prayer. I know I'm sealed with the Holy Spirit. I've received the Holy Spirit as a deposit. Listen to this. If you're a saved person, if you've trusted Jesus Christ by faith, the Spirit of God lives in you. You are sealed with the Spirit. No one can rob you of eternal life. I know that God is with me every day and that He'll never leave me nor forsake me. I know all things work together for my good and God's glory. And something else that I've been reminded of in the last couple of weeks, I know that when disasters happen, that doesn't mean God doesn't love me. And I know that God's going to complete His work. Can I confess something to you? Just saying that stuff in front of y'all makes my faith just sort of get pumped up. So if that didn't bless you, it blessed me. Just rehearsing the truth, saying those things, just sort of encourages me. And so what I'm telling you is this. We have to go back to the first principles. When we face crisis, when we face a mystery, when we face something that God's been involved in and we can't understand, and we have all these raging, unanswerable questions, don't focus on the doubts. Focus on what you know is true about the Lord. Look at question 2, verse 13. Habakkuk writes, your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You can't tolerate wrong. Why then do you tolerate the treacherous? Why are you silent while the wicked swallow up those who are more righteous than themselves? I mean, here's the heart of the problem. And we all understand that there are moral inequities in the universe. What do I mean by that? Some people seem to have it easy while other people suffer for years. There's no way to deny that observation. You know, we've all heard the saying, and we probably said it ourselves, into each life some rain must fall. But it seems like some folks get a sprinkle, and some folks live under a torrential downpour of pain. It doesn't seem fair. How do we explain it? Well, Habakkuk's particular problem stemmed from a seeming conflict in God. I mean, if God can't tolerate wrongdoing, how then could he use the Babylonians to judge Judah? I mean, Babylon's sins were much greater than Judah's sins. At least that was Habakkuk's opinion. Is this not a contradiction? Well, the answer is no. There's no contradictions with God. But it is true, he does things that seem to us to be inconsistent. But the key phrase here is seem to us. May I tell you that God's ways will not always make sense to us, not even when they're viewed through the eyes of faith. And maybe a better way to put it would be this, that in the short run, which is all of life for all of us, God's ways sometimes just won't make sense to us. In the short run, which is all of life for all of us, God's will, God's ways sometimes just don't make sense. We don't know why things happen the way they do. Sometimes we find out later. Sometimes we don't find out until we get to heaven. And every thoughtful person wrestles with this at some point in their lives. But eventually, we're forced back on what I call a foundational truth. Here it is. He's God and we're not. Note to self. He's God. We're not. He's sovereign. We're not. Nearly every mistake comes because we forget this basic truth. So it's good for all of us to remember Psalm 115, verse 3, which says, our God is in heaven. Watch this. He does whatever he pleases. Wow. Every time I read that verse, I want to act like I'm in front of a classroom and say, any questions about that? No, not for me, because whether you're reading it in English or Hebrew, here's what it means. Our God's in heaven. He does whatever he pleases. So at this point, God has not yet answered Habakkuk's question. That'll come in the next chapter. But for the moment, let me just simply note that any answer must go back to the truth that God is God and we're not. Don't miss this. Until you and I embrace that truth, we will forever struggle with the Lord. See, as long as you think you're still in the driver's seat, as long as you think you can call the shots, you will wrestle, you will struggle with the Lord. You must come back to this truth. You must embrace it with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength. He's God. We're not. Third question. How long will this last? Wow, that's a good question. Verse 17, the prophet writes, is he to keep on emptying his net, destroying nations without mercy? The he in this verse refers to the entire Babylonian army personified by King Nebuchadnezzar as one person. I mean, he just keeps on conquering nation after nation, and nobody can stop King Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonian army. I mean, if he sees a city, he wants it, he takes it. If he wants what you have, he takes it. If he captures you, he probably kills you. To him, men are like fish, and he just keeps on throwing out the net and reeling them in, one nation after another. And he's gone fishing again, and guess what nation he's after now? Judah. Judah. And in the face of this crushing evil, Habakkuk, the man of God, wonders, when's this going to stop? Will nobody stop Babylon? Will his reign of terror go on forever? I mean, who can stand in his way? And I think this touches the deepest question we have when life crumbles around us. How long will this last? See, most people can stand up under a load of trouble if they know eventually it's going to come to an end. Most people can deal with cancer if they know that chemo for 3 months or 6 months, even 12 months, is going to end and there's a light at the end of the tunnel. Most people can live under financial pressure if they know at some point there's going to be financial liberty. Most people can work through a problem with a spouse or a child or a sibling or a workmate if they know, if they sense, if they feel that there's an end in sight. Let me tell you what will drive you nuts when it feels like it's going to go on forever. Habakkuk's wondering, oh my God, is there no end in sight? Who's going to stop this wicked nation? He's wondering, Lord, if it never ends, how will we survive? So there's his three questions. Review, who are you, Lord? To which Habakkuk supplies his own answer. I like that. How can you do this? For which no answer is given. How long will this last? For which no answer is given. They're all honest questions. They're the kind of questions we ask when we're experiencing trouble. We should probably note that Habakkuk is such an honest guy. When he has doubts, he doesn't hesitate to express them to the Lord. He doesn't cover up his doubts. He doesn't make pious, platitudes. He doesn't give glib answers. He answers the only question he can answer. And he waits on God. He waits on God to answer the other two. He's confident in God, but he's totally confused by what God's doing in the world. He's a believing man with serious questions he can't answer. But now look at his decision in Habakkuk 2, verse 1. I will climb up into my watchtower now and wait to see what the Lord will say to me and how he'll answer my complaint. I like that. But did you see that word? Not my prayer. What did he say? Complaint. We're too religious to use that kind of language, quite frankly. We don't, I was praying to the Lord. No, you weren't. You were complaining. You were fussing. You were arguing. You were filled with doubts. And you know what I love about the Scripture? The Scripture does not sort of airbrush all these men and women in the Scriptures. He says, Lord, I'm climbing up into my tower. I've said my piece. Now I'm going to wait. See what you got to say about my complaint. Well, it was a prayer. It's just kind of a different kind of prayer than most of us think of in terms of prayer. I'm going to climb up there and wait. The word watchtower describes some sort of wooden structure that he probably built himself. And there, alone, he would watch and wait for God's answer to come. He didn't know how the Lord would answer. He didn't know how long he'd have to wait. He just knew that having said all that was on his heart, now it was time to wait on the Lord. He doesn't understand how God can use the wicked Babylonians to judge Judah for her sins, still not making sense to him. So he's just going to wait. I hope all of you are familiar with the little devotional book, My Utmost for His Highest, by Oswald Chambers. I got a copy of that in 1974 when I became a Christian. On one particular day, it says this. This has spoken to me over the last couple of weeks in a powerful way. God can never make us whine if we object to the fingers he uses to crush us. God would only use his own fingers and make me broken bread and poured out wine in a special way. But when he uses someone whom we dislike or some set of circumstances which we would never submit to, we object. Then he writes, we must never choose the scene of our own martyrdom. If ever we're going to be made wine to drink, we will have to be crushed. You can't drink grapes. Grapes become wine only when they've been crushed. And he goes on to say that if we fight against the Lord's plan for us, any wine that is produced in us will be bitter and undrinkable.
we have to be placed into God and brought into agreement with Him before we can be broken bread in His hands. Great advice. It's just kind of tough to practice in the real world. See, that's precisely where Habakkuk is living at this moment. He knows with all of his heart that Judah needs to be disciplined. Judah needs to be broken because of her sin. But the man of God cannot reconcile himself to God using the Babylonians as his appointed fingers for the crushing judgment that's coming. And so he makes a decision. I'll wait on the Lord. We don't know how long he waited, only that in God's time, God answered. See, at some point, all of us need to stop talking about our problems. But nobody likes to do that. Man, we love to talk. We love to talk to people. And sometimes we post stuff on Facebook and all kinds of social media that should never be posted for others to see. We just need, can I say it quite bluntly? We need to shut up. Quit talking. And get along with God. But some Christians just can't stop running their mouth. We can't stop complaining. We refuse to be still and know that He's God. Let me tell you something. That's why many of us are not getting the answer that we desperately need. Sometimes we must, after airing our complaint to Him, get alone. As we come to the end of the message, we've already reached a turning point in this brief book. Having laid out his complaints before the Lord, Habakkuk is now alone, waiting on God for an answer. Waiting here for you. Waiting here for you. And while he's been honest about his complaints, he's also been wise enough to take them to the Lord and leave them there. He took them to the Lord and he leaves them there, which really leads me to an important point. We're almost done. Our deepest problems are not psychological, sociological, and thank God, our deepest problems are not political. Our deepest problems are theological. Can God be trusted? And what kind of God do we believe in? What kind of God do I believe in? As I was thinking about the second question, what kind of God do we believe in? Couple thoughts came to me. Number one, he's not the God we think he is. Second thought, he's much better than that. Amen? He's not the God we think he is. He's much better than that. God's ways are better. God's heart is better. His thoughts are better. His plan is better. All that God is and all that God does is better. If you believe that, will you just encourage me and say amen? God is better. Because that's true, listen to me, we should not be surprised that we continually run into the problem of not understanding Him. And it shouldn't surprise us that when His answers come, a lot of times they don't line up with our desires. So the question comes again, what do you do? What do you do when you've prayed and you don't like the answer you've received? What do you do when you've prayed don't like the answer you've received? Well, you could try bargaining with God, but that doesn't work. You can get angry, vent your spleen, shout, carry on, but that doesn't work. You can ask God some questions, which is exactly what Habakkuk did. You can go back to first principles and remind yourself of who God is. That's what Habakkuk did. But most of all, you can decide to wait on the Lord in faith and hope and in confidence that what doesn't make sense right now will make sense later. And as you wait, you need to keep in mind that the Lord doesn't keep time the same way we do. A.W. Tozer said, God never hurries. There are no deadlines which He must work against. God never hurries. Someone else said, God's never early. God's never late. God's always on time. So for the moment, here's where we leave Habakkuk. He's aired all of his complaints,
And now he's climbed up into his watchtower. And as we leave him in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 1, he's looking, he's watching, he's waiting for the Lord to come and give him his answer. He's alone with God. He's waiting there for God. Waiting is good. It's good for the soul, especially if you're waiting on the Lord. And as you wait, you need to remember something. You need to remember that God has not forgotten you. Some of you think that. But you need to remind yourself, God's not forgotten me. You need to remember that He sees your confusion. He sees your fear, your distress, your anger, your discouragement, your sorrow. He sees it all and then some. But don't you dare get discouraged. But as you wait, you let your weary soul rest in this awesome promise found in Isaiah 40, 31. They who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. They shall walk and not stumble or fall. They who wait upon the Lord started off the service about a mother's journey, and it started to say something like, you know, each mother's journey is unique, and her journey went like this. You know what? That's where a lot of us are. Frozen. Stuck. Not moving forward. Not growing in intimacy with Christ. We started the journey where we've got the hand of someone else, and somewhere along the line, tragedy struck, a crisis came, a question arose, and Satan used it to dunk slam your faith. And instead of running to God and airing your complaint and then waiting on Him, you just sort of said, I'm not budging. That kind of defiance will never allow you to be made broken bread or poured out wine for the glory of God. We must submit to the fingers that God chooses to use in the breaking and the crushing process. It may be someone we do not like. It may be a circumstance we've said, I'll never submit to that. I will never embrace that. But God chooses things often. That don't make sense. But oh, the beauty of saying to Him, I don't get it. I don't even like it. But oh, how I trust You. And I'm going to wait. And maybe I'll get my answer on this side, or maybe I'll get my answer when I finally arrive in heaven, but I'm going to wait because He's God and I'm not. He's sovereign and I'm not. And all God's people say, stand up, please. Bow your heads. Stephen, come. Musicians, join us with the staff. Come. Join me here at the front. Maybe you've been hammered by one of those incredibly difficult questions in life that arises out of conflict or some crisis. For us, it's been the loss of a son, a dearly beloved son. For you, it may be financial crisis. For you, it may be medical. It may be marital. It may involve one of your children. It may involve, I don't know what it is, but some of you may be here this morning and you're scratching your head wondering, how could God do this? And how long is this going to last? And who are You, God? Those are good questions. Get them out. Take them to the Lord. lay them at his feet and leave them there, and then climb up in your watchtower, climb into your prayer closet, go to your private place where you and Jesus spent time together, and just say, now I'm waiting here for you. Waiting here for you. Don't go to people for answers. They will not be the kind of answers you need. Go to God. Go to his word. Wait for him. Wait for him. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Father, so many of us have questions that will never be answered adequately, probably during our entire life, but some may be answered. Maybe not right away, but sometime we still get the answers we long for while we're on this planet. Sometimes the answers come when we're with you in your presence, but the answers come. And Lord, for those who are here this morning as pilgrims, sojourners, traveling through this world, we want to say, this world's not our home. We're looking forward to a city that's not built with the hands of men, but built by the hands of God. But while we're journeying, Lord, we want to give all of our questions, all of our doubts, all of our frustrations, sometimes even our anger, to you. And affirm some of those basic truths, those first principles. You're God, we're not. You're good all the time. Your love endures forever. Jesus is the only way to heaven. There's a real heaven and there's a real hell. Christ is coming back sooner than we can imagine. All those things are truths that fire up our faith. May we be encouraged this morning, even with our nagging questions. May we simply run to you and wait for you to answer us in your time. And may we submit wholeheartedly to the fingers you choose to crush us so that we might be drinkable wine and broken bread in your hands to bless and encourage a dark, needy world. In your name we pray. For your glory we pray. Amen. Look this way. If you're here this morning and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, here's one of the truths that I'm embracing in a fresh way. Life is precious, but life is also fragile. Life is uncertain. Death is certain. It's appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. If you don't know Christ, you're standing on thin ice, spiritually speaking. Your future could change in the blink of an eye. Would you be ready to meet God and be accepted into his holy heaven? Without a viable relationship with Christ, you're not ready. Jesus said, ye must be born again. You need to repent of your sin and put all of your trust in the finished work of Christ. He died on the cross for you. He was buried. He was raised on the third day, ascended back into heaven. He's at the right hand of God today. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And nobody can get to heaven except through him. Do you know him? Not know about him. I didn't ask you if you're religious. Do you know him? If not, we would love to have the privilege to lead you in a real relationship with God through his Son, Jesus Christ. What about this? Are you here this morning and you've got some questions that have just been hammering you? And maybe you need to come and just say to one of us, that message touched a spiritual nerve, and I'm going to take my complaints, my frustrations to God, and I'm going to wait. We'd like to pray with you and pray for you. Maybe you're here today and you need a church. We have guests who've been with us for some time, week after week. Broadway's not a perfect church, but I'll tell you, I knew this before April 24th, but I'll tell you, this church is one great church filled with some of the most loving, wonderful, God-fearing people I've ever met in my life. Here's what I can promise you. They love God, and they'll love you. And we'll fumble through this together, trusting him. If you need a church home, if you love Jesus and you've been saved, we'd love to embrace you this morning.